book of Exodus, chapter 5. Book of Exodus, chapter 5. And verse 19. Exodus chapter 5 and verse 19. I'm going to read 19 through 23, continuing on Exodus chapter 6, verse 1 through 4. Just to give you the context of what's happening here, God tells Moses out of the burning bush, and he tells Moses, he says, look, I want you to go and let my people go. And Moses obeys the voice of God, and Pharaoh says no, and he says, by the way, not only am I saying no, but I want the burdens to be worse upon the children of Israel. And things are getting worse after he obeyed the voice of God. And the elders of Israel come because they're like, hold on, Moses, we had it all good before you came around here. And so they meet Moses on Moses' way out of Pharaoh's court. And this is what they say in verse 19. And the officers of the children of Israel did see that they were in an evil case after it was said, ye shall not minish aught from your breaks of your daily task. And they met Moses and Aaron, who stood in the way, as they came forth from Pharaoh, and they said unto him, the Lord look upon you and judge, because ye have made our savor to be abhorred in the eyes of Pharaoh and in the eyes of his servants, to put a sword in their hand to slay us. What they're saying is, look, Moses, look, things are getting worse. You got this big God idea, and now we're the one, you're not going to be the one laying bricks with no straw. We're the ones that suffer. And Moses returned unto the Lord and said, Lord, wherefore hast thou so entreated this people? Why is it that thou hast sent me? What Moses is saying, look, Lord, I told you I didn't want to go. And now things are getting worse. For since I came to Pharaoh to speak in thy name, he hath done evil to this people, neither hast thou delivered thy people at all. Exodus 6 verse 1, continuing on. Then the Lord said unto Moses, now, oh my word, I'm going to preach this thing here tonight. No, I'm sorry. The word just kind of comes out at you. He said, now shalt thou see what I will do to Pharaoh, for with a strong hand shall he let them go, and with a strong hand shall he drive them out of his land. And God spake unto Moses and said unto him, I am the Lord, and I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty, but by my name Jehovah was I not known to them. And I have also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage, wherein they were strangers. Watch this. Moses encounters resistance. But after Moses encounters resistance, God speaks to Moses and says, Moses, because you were willing to encounter the resistance, you're going to get a revelation of me that no generation before you has ever gotten. Amen. Yeah. 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 He said, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they knew me by the name God Almighty, but they didn't know me by Jehovah, because they're not facing the resistance that you're about to face. But because you are willing to encounter the resistance, you're going to get a deeper revelation like never before. And I want to preach on this topic, the power of resistance. The power of resistance. Why don't you lay your Bibles down? Everyone close your eyes and lift up your hands. Let's ask the Holy Ghost to touch us here tonight. Lord Jesus, you know what's happening here. You know, oh God, what every person here is dealing with, God. You are the vine and we are the branches. I pray that you would anoint my voice. I pray that you would anoint your people. I pray that there would be a demonstration of your spirit like never before. Cause them to believe the anointing, oh God, that is upon them. Cause them to believe where they're going in the power of the revelation and anointing that is upon this place. Open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing. God, do what only you can do here tonight.
tonight, Jesus. We must stir something up inside of each of us in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Next to you and tell them there is power in resistance. And you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Israel, they were God's chosen people, laden with the responsibility and destiny to spread God's name throughout the entire world. Through them, God told Abraham, all of the nations of the world are going to be blessed because of your walk with me. Through them, God wanted to bless the entire world. Through their walk with God, God wanted the blessing to come upon those around them. But this chosen vessel is now dwelling comfortably in Egypt in the land of Goshen. Right. It was prophesied generations earlier to Abraham that his seed, his offspring, would be in the land of captivity for 400 years. But when we read the scripture, we understand that Israel did not come out of Egypt until after 430 years. They stayed 30 years beyond their prophesied moment that they were supposed to come out. They stayed 30 years longer than God wanted them to in the land of Egypt. It was because they were chosen but comfortable. They were called but complacent. Expectation and exploits were taken hostage by Eve, and they dwelt in the land of Goshen, which was the best of the land of Egypt. They dwelt in Goshen, which means to draw near. They were content to draw near their destiny, but didn't have the fervor or tenacity to walk into their destiny. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of coming close, and I'm ready to walk into the anointing. Coming near, but not walking in the anointing. I almost prayed through. I almost had a harvest. I almost grasped revival. But they did not have the fervor to say, I'm discontent with coming close, and I'm ready to walk in the power and anointing that God wants me. They became comfortable being near where they were supposed to be, but didn't have the fervor, our tenacity, our faith to walk in the power of their destiny. Can I tell you, history does not remember people that almost make it happen. I come to tell you here tonight, all of us understand Alexander Graham Bell is the first person to invent the telephone. But hear me, somebody, tonight, that Alexander Graham Bell was not the first to start the invention of the telephone. He was just the first to finish it. It was Elisha Gray. You don't even know his name. Elisha Gray, he was the one that put the invention of the telephone. And while he was procrastinating to get it patented, he showed up hours later after Alexander Graham Bell's lawyer put the patent in on the telephone. And hours later, his lawyer shows up to put in the patent. And so he was the one that started the invention, but he wasn't the one to finish it. And nobody knows who Elisha Gray is, because nobody
almost gets it done, that almost invented, that almost followed through. I started, but I didn't finish. I began, but I didn't finish. I had the faith to start, but I didn't have the faith to get it done. Oh, my word. And Elisha Gray, the reason why he really started trying to finish it in a hurry is when he heard Alexander Graham Bell was coming so close to get it done. Can I tell you, if we don't have the fervor to get it done, we're going to watch our peers fall up, pass by us on the wayside, pass by us walking in their calling, in their destiny. But it's time for somebody to get the zeal and fervor to say, I am discontent with being in this comfortable state. Was looking for a vehicle to drive Israel out of their comfort zone and into their destiny. And he found something called resistance. Sometimes God will use resistance to accomplish his purpose for our lives. Romans chapter 9 and verse 17 says it this way: For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for this same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. God was saying, I am the one that raised up Pharaoh.
Come on.
I am the one that raised up the resistance. You're praying for me to take him out, but I'm the one that put him in.
Come on.
He said, you were comfortable where you were, so I've got to raise up a Pharaoh that knew not Joseph. I've got to raise up a resistance that you're not going to have favor with. I've got to raise up a leader that you're not going to have favor with. Because if you have favor with them, you'll be content in your comfort zone. And you won't be able to walk in the power of your anointing. So I'm going to raise up a person to resist you into the will of God. I'm going to raise up a person to resist you into the power of God. Oh, my word. With everything that's happening in the American culture, with all the hell that's broken in the United States government, with everything, the condition of our world is just messed up. But I fear more what the church would be if that resistance was not there. Because if that resistance was not there, we'd be at ease in Zion. We'd be building our barns. We'd be building our lives without even a second thought. Out of the hand of captivity for this purpose. He said, it's because the enemies have begun to blaspheme my name and begin to make fun of the children of Israel. And he said, I am going to deliver the Israelites, not because of anything that they have done, not because of their right. Jesus. Not because of anything. He said, but I am going to deliver them because of the holiness of my name. Yeah. And because my name is tied to them, I'm going to deliver. God will do whatever it takes to protect his name. Can I tell you how blessed this church is to be the people of the name? Provoke them into their destiny. God raised up a Pharaoh that knew not Joseph, and their resistance forced them to cry out to God for a deliverance.
Right.
If the affliction and the resistance never came, they wouldn't have cried out.
That's right, that's right.
But because the pain was there, they cried out to God for a deliverer. And God answered their prayer with Moses.
Yes.
God raises up Moses. Moses, he's born as a goodly and proper child. And he's sent away in the water in the ark, which found by the bulrushes. As Pharaoh's daughter comes out and finds the baby. Moses' name means drawn out. And now Moses is raised, God's chosen, watch this, in Pharaoh's house. God raised a baby in Pharaoh's house so Moses would not conform to the comfortable Israelite prone mindset. God said, I can't raise up Moses in the around Israel. If I want him to be successful, in Pharaoh's house. But finally, Acts 7 says it this way, as Stephen was preaching, that Moses killed an Egyptian for this reason, watch this, supposing that Israel might understand that by his hands he was their deliverer. God, Moses killed an Egyptian knowing he was called, knowing he was chosen, and he supposed that the Israelites would rather rally behind him to go take down Pharaoh with a mighty army. But God was saying, Moses, it's not going to be a man thing. It's going to be a God. Yes. Yes. Moses, he kills that Egyptian because he feels the call. And he kills that Egyptian to where he makes a mistake.
Yeah.
And after 40 years of being in the land of Midian, a strange land, God speaks to Moses out of a burning bush and says, Moses, I know that you made a mistake, but you're still my called and you're still my man for the hour.
Yeah.
What God was saying was, I'd rather use a Moses that made a mistake than to use somebody with all the talent and ability, but that's so comfortable. Yeah. aren't called, you're still chosen. And you're going to deliver the Israelites out of captivity. And Moses' first response to God's profound statement was this: who am I?
Come on,
right?
Come on,
I stutter.
Yeah.
And God's response to Moses was this: Moses?
Yes, Lord.
What's in your hand? A staff? Okay, that's enough.
Yes. Come on.
What you have in your hand is enough to get the job done.
Come on.
Oh, I've got to preach this.
Come on.
It's amazing to me that Satan always discourages you over what you do not have.
Yes.
What you do have, because what you do have is enough. What the church has is enough. Under the mighty Lord, and the anointed Lord, and the Lord is forever. It's amazing to me that Satan discouraged Eve over what she did not have, so he could come back door and steal what she did have, because what she did have was enough for eternal life. Can I tell you, I put the Holy Ghost here. Satan's main agenda against this church is majoring on what you're missing. Hey, the music isn't as you would like it. Hey, you need some help. You need some help from the outside. You can't without some people on the outside who can no. He's telling you that because he's so afraid of what's already in here. Because he's already in here. Satan wants to discourage you over the talent and the skill that you may be missing, because as he gets you looking out there, you won't protect what's in here. And what's in here is enough to get the job done. I'm talking to every preacher here. I'm talking to every young person here. I'm talking to every elder here. Whatever church you're from, I'm telling you that the revival that God wants to bring, he's wanting to bring it out of what you already possess. Look, Church of Philadelphia, here, you're struggling. Let me tell you something. You've been through a lot of earthquakes, Philadelphia. But let me tell you, Church of Philadelphia in Revelation, let me tell you the qualifications for an open door. Here's what he said. He said, you have a little strength. You've not denied my name, and you've kept my word. He said, this door is open based upon what you do have, and not upon what you do not. Can I tell this church that the door is open over this church, because you are not denied the name, you kept my word, and you have a little strength, and the door is open based upon what you're holding on to.
Come on.
I think I'm helping somebody here. Jesus. Now, God identifies the gift in Moses. He identifies that the power is in God in Moses. He says, Moses, there's a gift in you. And Moses, that staff in your hand is enough to get the job done.
Yeah.
Moses, 40 years, he's herding sheep with a staff in his hand, beating himself up in the wilderness, beating himself up in isolation. I made a mistake. I don't have the call anymore. I don't have the drive or the passion anymore. But the whole time for 40 years, he's holding the very instrument that God would use to split the Red Sea and bring the 10 plagues. Moses is beating himself up, but he's walking around with the very instrument that God would use.
After he identifies the gift, Moses goes back to Egypt with the prophetic voice of God still ringing in his ears. He comes out of a fresh camp meeting service. He comes out of a fresh men's conference. He comes out of a fresh altar call with hearing the voice of God and the revival and the deliverance that's already coming. And he goes there in the confidence of God's voice. He goes there as the anointing is on him. He goes there knowing beyond the shadow of a doubt that God had spoke to him. And as he walks in, he busts through the doors of Pharaoh's court. And he looks Pharaoh smack dab in the eye. And he says, "Let my people go."
Amen.
Let me try this again. I don't know if you heard me.
Let my people go.
Yes.
Pharaoh, I don't think you heard me, son. I said no. Okay, Lord. That didn't actually go as I envisioned it.
Yes, right.
All right, Pharaoh, you're asking for this, okay. Aaron, give me my staff, okay, here. You see this, Pharaoh? It's a staff. Watch this. It's a snake. Pharaoh, magicians come, not musicians. Magicians come, show this boy something. They bring their staffs and they made two snakes.
Right.
Okay, Lord, I wasn't expecting all this. I obeyed your voice.
Yeah.
And I immediately have met resistance.
Yeah. Right.
Come on. Yeah.
Come on, man.
Wow. And he goes. And he immediately meets resistance as Pharaoh says no. And he goes to God and says, "God, why did you even send me?" And God's first words are, "Now!
Now.
Shalt thou see what I'm going to do to Pharaoh." I, Moses, I wanted you to see the insurmountable task that was before you. I wanted you to see that your favor isn't going to get this job done. I wanted you to see all the gifts and talents that I've given you isn't going to get this done. That God had put upon him with the voice of God ringing in his ears. Moses discovered that him alone, he could not get it done. But he needed God to hold his hand to bring him through that resistance. God allowed him to see how impossible it was. Oh, Jesus, help me, Holy Ghost. That you can understand that you are your praise and your prayer and your fasting and your consecration isn't the thing that's going to get this done. The only thing that's going to bring Moses, and because you were willing to take it all, you're going to get a revelation of me that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob never had. They only knew me by the name God Almighty because they haven't faced this resistance, Moses. But because you were willing to take on the resistance in my name, you're going to discover a revelation of me that I am Jehovah, and you've got a revelation that no preceding generation has ever had of me. He had to leave his home, go to the Roman theater, go to the Colosseum, go out there and mess with some things. But we're living in a day and age where we can fall in sin in a room by ourselves, holding our smartphone in our hands, looking at a wrong website, and we can fall in sin with nobody around us. Abortions, we've never faced resistance like this before. Because we're willing to live for God despite these conditions. Because we're willing to hold on to our faith. Because we're willing to be faithful in this time. God says it's not in vain, because you're about to discover revelation of my faithfulness and how I am able to keep you by the word of God. And he that has begun a good work in you shall also be able to perform it out to the day of Jesus Christ. So don't think what you're holding on right now that nobody sees what this church is doing. But God's eyes are attentive on that road. God's eyes are attentive on this church, because even all the hell that you've been through, you're still going to hold on and stand fast. And God says, you've got the revelation, and in a life that is impossible to please him. And he that cometh to God must first believe that he is. You've got that revelation. And he says, now you're about to get another revelation. Now that you've got the revelation that you believe that I is, he says, but and I am a rewarder of them that diligently seek me. Moses, go again until your resistance is met with deliverance. Go again until your resistance becomes a revival. Go again until your resistance is met with your revelation. Sometimes resistance comes because of what we are doing right and not because of what we are doing wrong. Resistance comes because of what's right with you and not because of what's wrong with you. But if I told you what you're fighting right now isn't because of the bad that you've done, but it's because of the good that you've done. But if I told you what you're fighting right now, it's not because of how bad you are, but because of how good you are. I've come to preach to somebody with the anointing. God has come to provoke you. Am I helping somebody?
Yes.
Sometimes you've got to endure the resistance to get the revelation. Sometimes you've got to endure ashes to get beauty. Sometimes you've got to endure mourning to get the oil of joy. Sometimes you've got to endure heaviness to put on the garment of praise. You will not get a revelation that you never got. Somebody here. Somebody said it this way. I'd rather be on the rough road going somewhere than to be on a clear road going nowhere. I'd rather go through something to get something than to go through nothing but get nothing. I'd rather go through hell to get to heaven than to have heaven on earth but go to hell. Come on, somebody. You're the one, Job. You prayed for me to give you the double blessing. Now don't beat me up when I give you what you've been praying for, not how you envisioned it to come. Sometimes we pray for God to do things in us and in our church, and we expect the answer to come out of the front door. But sometimes the answer sneaks out back on us on the back door. Answers your prayer when you turn around and say, "My Lord, look what God has done. I didn't see him working before, but I found out on the left he can work even if it's in the darkness." Job, don't beat me up. You're the one that wanted the double blessing. Now all this hell is broken loose in your life, Job. And after 38 chapters, Job didn't hear a word from God. But finally, in the 38th chapter, the Bible says that the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind. That word whirlwind in the Hebrew, it means a storm. Sometimes God's best answers come out of a storm. As you had before. Don't beat me up, Elisha. You're the one that wanted the mantle. Now I've got to take your mantle away in the whirlwind, which means a storm. But don't beat me up, Elisha, because there's a mantle falling out of that storm. There's a mantle. Says, he even drove Jesus into the wilderness. This is what the Bible says in Mark 1. This is my beloved son, and whom I am well pleased. Next verse, and immediately the Spirit driveth him into the wilderness. Sometimes the Spirit will drive you into a rough place. And loneliness. And if you can hear the voice of heaven saying, I'm pleased with you. You may not feel my presence, but I'm pleased with you. You may feel more. revelation. Go again, Moses. Go back to Pharaoh's court. And Moses, he goes back to Pharaoh's court. And he says, let my people go. But Pharaoh says no. Let my people go. Pharaoh says no. Let my people go. And Pharaoh says no. But the more he encountered the resistance, he discovered a deeper and deeper revelation of who God was. Because now, when Pharaoh brought the resistance and said no, God backed Moses up and brought the 10 plagues. And after each plague, he discovered a deeper dimension of God's omnipotence and omniscience. God brought judgment to the false gods of Egypt. He brought judgment to the Egyptian sun god, Ra. And he judged the Egyptian sun god, Ra, with darkness. And when Moses saw the darkness, he said, God is for me. God is on my side. He's still in control of the sun. But Moses, he kept on going. And now the frogs come out of the ground. And that was God putting judgment on the Egyptian frog god, Hejet, the fertility god. And as Moses keeps on going, he keeps on discovering a deeper and deeper revelation of who God was. But finally, he gets the final revelation. The whole reason he went through that hill was to get the final revelation. He keeps going until he gets the revelation of Passover. Moses keeps going until he sees the blood of the Lamb. What are you saying, brother? Discovers the blood of the Lamb, which was the foreshadowing of Jesus Christ, the perfect Lamb, whose blood coming and keeping us and washing our sins away. But he went through the resistance to get a revelation of the Lamb's blood like never before. He keeps on going until his resistance was met with the blood of the Lamb. Moses, he got through the resistance because here it is, he had the tenacity to just keep on going.
I'm sorry, I feel at home here tonight, and I'm just gonna preach this thing here tonight. My word, anybody feel the Holy Ghost here?
But just keep on going. I may be sick, but I'm gonna keep on coming up front to pray. I may be down, but I'm gonna keep on walking through those church doors until I get my deliverance. I may be struggling right now, but I'm gonna just keep on coming. I may be in hell right now, but I'm gonna just keep on coming. Things might not be going my way right now, but I'm gonna just keep on. And the custom was, if your first wife doesn't bear your children, it was considered shameful in this time. And Hannah, she hadn't born any children, for the Lord had shut up her womb. And Hannah is barren with no kids. And the custom was in the ancient Near East, if your first wife doesn't bear your children, go ahead and marry another one so you can preserve your inheritance and your offspring after you die. So Elkanah, he marries a second wife named Penaniah. And the Bible says that Penaniah had many children. And Penaniah had so much children that she began to provoke Hannah's sword and began to afflict Hannah for being barren. Hannah would wake up in the middle of the night hearing the sound of children crying, and Penaniah whispering in her ear, you'll never have any children, as her adversary began to provoke Hannah sore. But Hannah, she responded to her resistance and affliction the right way, because the affliction from Penaniah led into the house of God to make a prayer to God. To make a prayer to God and petition God and say, God, if you'll just give me a man child, I'll devote him back to you. But let me tell you something. Hannah would have never would have been content to remain barren if it wasn't for the resistance from Pariah. And you and I will be content to remain barren until God sends the affliction your way. Hannah, she endures the resistance. Hannah, you've got to endure your resistance because there's a prophet in your womb. Hannah, there's a miracle in your womb, Hannah, but it takes resistance to get it out. Hannah, she would have been content. Hannah, she has a son named the prophet Samuel. And after the prophet Samuel, he was the one that would anoint King David. And through King David's loins would come Jesus Christ, the Messiah. One prayer, he shuts up the heaven for 3.5 years. And after 3.5 years of no rain coming, finally he prays and petitions God. And he tells his servant, servant, I want you to go see if there's rain coming. And that servant goes, and he comes back, and look what he tells Elijah. There's nothing. And Elijah just said, well, go again.
Come on.
Go again.
Yeah.
Right.
Until your resistance is met with the sound of abundance. It's another word for covenant. God is the one that instituted that covenant. He was the testator. He made a covenant with Abraham. In Genesis 17, that was the covenant of circumcision. He made a covenant with Moses, which was the tabernacle plan. And he made that covenant of the tabernacle plan so he could have communion with mankind. But look what God found out, because they didn't keep their end of the bargain. Look what he said, these people draw nigh to me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They're still sacrificing, but they're still sinning their heart. What are you saying, Brother Jackson? God found out that the tabernacle wasn't enough to get the job done. Praise and labor wasn't enough to draw mankind unto him. The praise and altar wasn't enough. The Aaron's rod and bud wasn't enough. The pot of manna wasn't enough. The ark of the covenant, the cherubims, it wasn't enough. The table of shewbread, the altar of incense, the five pillars, it wasn't enough to bring mankind And the Bible says, look what he said. The Bible says that when they made those sacrifices, that it could not purge man from all of their sins, but it only pushed their sins 1 year ahead. The tabernacle, it wasn't enough. Hebrews says it this way, that there wouldn't be need for a new covenant if there wasn't power. That's dead. And now look what the Bible says, that where a testament is, there must be of necessity the death of a testator. So the only way for the old covenant to end, and the only way for a new one to begin, until God died.
That's right.
Yes.
But God cannot die because he's a spirit. God made a covenant with Moses and said, Moses, you keep your part. I'm going to keep my part. I'm initiating this covenant. But Moses dies and the next generation keeps dying off and not serving God. So God is bound by his own covenant because he cannot die.
Yes.
And the only way to start a new covenant was for him to die.
Come on, preach it.
That's why the Bible says that God purchased the church with his own blood. It was God himself. In him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead family. It pleased the Father that in him the fullness as well. It was God who came down, born of a Virgin Mary, and died on the cross. But God said, I gotta go again until I die for their sins. I gotta go again until the Holy Ghost is poured out. If you haven't felt the presence of God again, you just gotta shout again. There's his power in trying again. I've come to preach to the minister here, and I'll come to preach to this church, that sometimes you just gotta go again. You gotta go again until the anointing falls. You gotta, I haven't seen the results that I wanted to happen yet. Well, God says, well, just go again. Well, I haven't seen the revival as I thought I would see it this time. Well, God says, well, just go again, because your revelation is on the other side of this resistance.
Yes.
Come on. I want everyone to come forward clapping their hands unto the Lord.
function. Born with all types of things hanging over us. Born with all types of things surrounding us. And God has only one antidote to resolve all that pain. And he just says, why don't you get born again? Because my second birth takes care of all the hell I went through in my first birth. Can I tell you something? You're looking at a Christian that the only way I can even be here is just based upon the power of going again. Born into dysfunction. Beaten for 12 years by my stepdad. Fist flying at my face every day. Never knew what true love really was. Felt like I could never do anything. I wasn't born into church. Felt like I could never accomplish anything. Hurt, pain, about to give up. Found basketball, played basketball to try to fill the void that I was facing. Try to fill the emptiness that I was facing. The rejection I was facing. And through that passion for basketball, I got a college basketball scholarship to the College of Central Florida. I went to the College of Central Florida. And I played there. I gave my all. Woke up 6:30 every morning, giving my all to a basketball. Never drank or smoked because I was consecrated to that sport. But I found out that the basketball couldn't take the pain away. And the basketball couldn't take the hurt away. And only Jesus had the power to wash and cleanse me. There was a Bible study that was happening on that campus. And in that Bible study, they began to talk about receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues. And I asked them, what church did you go to? Can you pick me up? They picked me up for church that Sunday morning, March 15th. And they brought me to church. And I went to that altar as Bishop James Barnum began to preach on eternity. And I lifted up my hands. And about 11:45 a.m., God filled me with the gift of the Holy Ghost. And after I got the Holy Ghost, I didn't talk the same. I didn't walk the same. When pain came my way, the Holy Ghost would rise up inside of me and say, you just got to keep on going. You've come too far to give up now. Oh, my God, help me, Holy Ghost. Can I tell you, God did not bring you in here tonight to put a death sentence over you. God did not bring you here tonight to tell you that you're a failure. God did not bring you here after all the hell that you've been through. There is something coming your way, but you just got to keep going and keep holding on no matter what happens. God did not draw you in here to fail. God did not save you to fail. God did not bring you here to leave you and forsake you now. God's hand's been on you from a youth. God's hand's been on you before you were even born. And he drew you into this house tonight. And he's asking you, can you still have the power to just keep going again, even when resistance is contrary to everything that you believe in? I want you to grab the person's hand next to you right now. I want everyone to lift up those hands up to God and make a decision that I'm not going to give up now and I'm not going to turn back now. I'm just going to keep on. Come on, everyone, let's lift up your voice. I'm going to keep on going. No matter what pain comes my way, no matter what hurt comes my way, I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to stop this. I've come too far. Come on, somebody lift up your voice. I'm not going to cry.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, we lift our hands in worship as we lift your holy name.
Thank you.
worship. We worship. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. We worship. Hallelujah, we worship. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, you are worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. And you are nobody like you are. Nobody like you are.
Give myself away, so real, can you see? Give myself away.
Give myself
her up, Brother Jackson, for what he's doing. You need to go tonight. I hold your people in this place in Jesus' name. Those of you that aren't in a hurry, tomorrow night revival continues with Brother Brandon Nero, 7 p.m. We've had a change for Sunday. I was just responding to a text message. Brother Miller's not going to be here. But we have a substitute. I've asked Brother Kendrick to bring the word Sunday at 3. Amen. So if you could come back tomorrow night, we'd love to have you. We'd love to be here Sunday at 3. We'd love you to be here. Amen. Let's go for the ministry of Brother Jackson. Tonight, would you clap your hands unto the Lord? Thank the Lord for this.
Protect them and keep them and continue to use them for your glory, Jesus. would give them a safe trip to wherever their next destination is, Jesus. That your hand be upon their ministry. Pray that you bless them the way they blessed us through you tonight, O God. Pray you begin to bless the Grimes Church, O Lord, the Cincernale Church. I pray, God, that you bless the Sullivan's ministry, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all these that are here tonight. Thank you for all that we have received of you. I pray that you continue to walk with us tonight, tomorrow, into each night of this revival. Strengthen us. Help us to go deeper into Jesus. We give you all praise and all glory and all honor. In Jesus' blessed name. Amen. Let the church say amen. Amen. Let your hands up, Lord. You are dismissed in the fear of the Lord. In Jesus' name.